estamos ahí.
So we're ready. Yeah, today we're going to be touching about this subject. We are going to touch up until the third dispensation. You have already the material in PDF. And then during the week, we're going to meet again with Apostle Fernando to see the rest of the dispensations for a total of seven. So today we're going to see three of them. And we're going to start with a prayer. Let me just get my veil for a moment. Oramos entonces.
Oremos.
Let's pray.
Padre que estás en el cielo, te damos gracias.
Father, who are in heaven, we thank you.
Bendicimos esta mañana tu nombre.
We bless this morning your name.
Y te suplicamos, Señor, que nos ampares y nos des la sabiduría para explicar tu palabra.
And we ask, Lord, for you to give us the wisdom to be able to explain your word.
Te ruego, Señor, que nos enseñes, Padre, con una unción magistral.
I ask, Lord, for you to teach us with a teaching anointing.
Que todo esto abra nuestro entendimiento para poder educar a otros, Señor.
For you to open up our understanding so that we can in turn teach to others.
En el nombre poderoso de Jesús te damos gracias.
In the powerful name of Jesus, we thank you.
Y te bendecimos, Señor.
And we bless you, Lord.
Amén.
Amen.
Bueno, este tema es un tema que necesita, antes de empezar, hacer algunas aclaraciones.
With this teaching, before we begin, it calls for a clarification before I begin teaching it.
Nosotros somos totalmente creyentes de la Biblia.
We completely believe in the Bible.
Pero no cabe duda que la Biblia, cuando se hizo paralelamente al pueblo de Israel, habían otros pueblos.
But nevertheless, when the Bible was written parallel to the to Israel, there were other people, other nations.
Y tenemos que considerar que la Biblia fue escrita en su tiempo para el pueblo de Israel.
And we have to take into consideration that the Bible was written in its time for the people of Israel.
Al nosotros entrar dentro de la dispensación de Cristo,
when we enter into the dispensation of Christ,
entonces automáticamente nosotros recibimos esa palabra también para nosotros.
Automatically we receive the word that was written for Israel also for us.
Y definitivamente al poderla estudiar vemos la relación también que Israel tuvo con esas culturas que vivían alrededor.
And when we study it, we also see the relationship that Israel had with the cultures that were around it.
Me parece bien tremendo o raro el hecho de que diga que Noé era perfecto en todas sus generaciones.
To me, it's very interesting and even a little bit strange when we read that Noah was perfect in his generations.
También vemos que Dios agarró a Abraham para hacer una nación grande.
We also see that God took Abraham to make of him a large generation.
Y cuando vemos el registro genealógico, nos damos cuenta que Abraham era descendiente de Noé.
And when we look at when we look at the genealogy, we notice that Abraham was a descendant of Noah.
Y Noé era descendiente de Adán.
And Noah was a descendant of Adam.
Entonces, cuando vemos la genealogía en el libro de Lucas,
when we read the genealogy of Christ in the book of Luke,
vemos que a pesar de que en los ancestros de Jesucristo hubo la mezcla de otras culturas,
we
o de
see
otras
that,
razas, that even, la línea se guardó.
We see that even though in the life of Christ there were different mixtures, the line was preserved. The genealogy line was preserved.
Entonces, cuando se abre la puerta o la dispensación de los gentiles,
so when the dispensation for the Gentiles is opened,
La Biblia deja de ser un libro para Israel y se vuelve un libro para todo aquel que quiera recibir esa genealogía, ya no por línea de varón, sino que por la línea de Dios.
When we enter into the dispensation of Christ, the Bible stops being a book for the people of Israel, and it becomes a book for all the nations if we decide to take part of it, not through a genealogy of men, but through the genealogy of Christ.
No podríamos ignorar que ahorita, en este momento, el mundo tiene sus propias culturas y nosotros tenemos nuestra cultura en Cristo.
Amen. We could not ignore that right now, at this moment, the world has its own cultures, but we have our own culture through Christ.
A través del tiempo, los arqueólogos han ido investigando cómo la Biblia ha ido manifestando todas las etapas de la historia.
Through time, archaeologists have been researching and finding out throughout history the relationship with the Bible.
Y así como otras culturas tuvieron una revelación que no es de esta tierra, así también nosotros tenemos una revelación que viene fuera de esta tierra.
And just as the other cultures had a revelation that does not come from this earth, we have the revelation that comes not from this earth.
Podemos ver, por ejemplo, que en las pirámides de Egipto hay escritura muy, pero muy antigua que refleja visitantes de afuera de esta tierra.
We can see, for example, in the pyramids from Egypt that reveals very ancient writings, and within them we find visitation to them from beings outside of this earth.
Vemos a los sumerios y a los asirios.
We see the Sumerians and the Assyrians. Los sumerios y los asirios.
Han tenido ese tipo de revelación externa.
Who have had this type of external revelation.
Vemos en los mayas también.
We also see this in the Mayan.
Pero cuando ya vamos, por ejemplo, a Asia más profunda, como la India y China, ya vemos una influencia de dragones, por ejemplo.
But when we go to Asia, in China and India, for example, we see an influence of a dragon, for example.
De seres mitológicos que tienen varias manos.
Of mythological beings that have several hands.
De personas que tenían caras de animales.
Of people who had faces of different animals.
Y definitivamente es fácil para nosotros decir que todo eso es del diablo, porque lo es.
And it's very easy for us to say that all of this is from the devil, because it is.
Pero tenemos que considerarlo y estudiarlo.
But we do have to consider it and study it.
Y entonces dice la Biblia en el libro de Eclesiastés 1:9.
And so the Bible says in the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 1, verse 9. ¿Lo leo?
Sí.
What has been will be again. What has been done will be done again. There is nothing new under the sun. Is there anything of which you can say, look, this is something new? It was here already long ago. It was here before our time. No one remembers the former generations, and even those yet to come will not be remembered by those who follow them.
Cuando vemos aquí es que hay algo que ya fue.
So in here we see something that has already been,
que ya existió,
which already existed,
y que lo que vemos es algo repetido.
And what we see is something that repeats itself.
La primera pregunta sería, ¿en dónde existió?
The first question would be, where did it exist?
¿Será que existió aquí mismo o que fue un plano preexistencial de esta creación?
Did it exist already here in this space that we have, or did it exist in a pre-existential plan about this creation or in reference to this creation?
Todos nosotros sabemos de que David dijo, todos mis días están escritos en tu libro.
We know that David said, all of my days are written in your book.
También dice en el libro de Romanos que Dios amó a Jacob y aborreció a Saúl antes de que naciera.
Yeah, also it says in the book of Romans that God loved Jacob and rejected Esau even before they were born.
¿De dónde vino eso?
Where did we get this? Where did it come from?
Ese sentimiento de Dios hacia Esau.
That feeling, that emotion from God towards Esau.
¿Será que en el plano preexistencial ya Esau había cometido un error que había ofendido a Dios?
Could it be that in the pre-existential plane, Esau had already committed something that did not delight God, that God did not, was not pleased by it?
Entonces, no cabe duda que hay un pasado, un presente y un futuro profético.
So there is no doubt there is a past, a present, and a future, a prophetic past, present, and future.
Y cuando vemos la diferencia entre Daniel y el apóstol Juan.
And when we look at the difference between Daniel and the apostle John.
Vemos que el apóstol Juan tuvo una visión un poco más extensa, tanto hacia el pasado como hacia el futuro, cuando vio la visión de los ocho reyes.
We see that John had a more extensive view or revelation of the past and the future when he was looking at the eight kings.
Cuando él estaba escribiendo, estaba viviendo en el Imperio Romano.
When he was writing, he was living through the Roman Empire.
Y después, básicamente a Juan le dicen que el imperio donde él vive, ese no es.
And later, John is told that the empire where he lives, that is not the empire.
Y el imperio que viene después de donde él vive, es un imperio que va a tardar poco tiempo.
And the empire that is coming, it's an empire that will last for a short time.
Entonces, podemos observar lo siguiente.
So we can observe the following.
Que la visión de Daniel empezó en Babilonia.
That the vision of Daniel, the vision that Daniel had, began in Babylon.
Después Medo-Persia.
Then Medo-Persia.
Después Grecia.
Then Greece.
Después Roma.
And then Rome.
Y después Daniel habló de ese imperio que se iba a levantar y era el imperio del anticristo.
And then Daniel spoke of the kingdom that would rise, the empire that would rise, and that is the empire of the Antichrist.
Ahora, vemos en Juan.
Now we see in John.
Que la relación de este último imperio con los demás es que este último imperio es todo lo que los demás contienen. O sea que es una mutación de todos los imperios que han habido en la tierra.
Now we see in the vision of John that it is a mutation, if you say, of all of the kingdoms or of all of the empires that have been on earth.
Por lo tanto, dice que va a venir por poco tiempo y que va a salir este último imperio de los siete imperios anteriores.
And this is why it says that it will come for a short time and that this empire will come forth from the other empires.
Entonces, la panorámica que tuvo Juan fue mucho más amplia.
So the panorama that John had was more, was greater, was more expansive.
Daniel vio cinco imperios y Juan vio siete imperios.
And Daniel saw five empires and John saw seven empires.
Y un último imperio que concatenan los dos profetas.
And one last empire that joins both prophets.
Entonces todo esto ya está escrito.
So all of this is already written.
Tenemos que analizar que Daniel estaba escribiendo en Babilonia y él vio hacia adelante.
We have to analyze that John, that Daniel was writing in Babylon, and Daniel estaba escribiendo en Babilonia.
Y vio hacia adelante, hacia el futuro.
And he saw forward, he saw towards the future.
Juan estaba escribiendo en Roma.
And John was writing in Rome.
Vio hacia el pasado.
He saw towards the past.
Y después vio hacia el futuro.
And then he saw towards the future.
Entonces, ambas profecías se concatenaron con un resumen.
So both prophecies were joined by a summary.
Y es el hecho de que paralelamente a la escritura de Dios
and
hay
culturas antiguas.
Paralelo a la escritura de Dios hay culturas antiguas que tenemos que estudiarlas para poder entender.
And it is the fact that parallel to the cultures and the scripture of God, there are cultures that we need to study, ancient cultures that we need to study.
Leamos Efesios 1:9.
Let's read Ephesians 1:9. It says, He made known to us the mystery of his will according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in Christ to be put into effect when the times reach their fulfillment in the dispensation, that is, it's in parentheses, when the times reach their fulfillment to bring unity to all things in heaven and on earth under Christ.
Entonces, esto es como una gran llave que se abrió.
So this is a key, a big key that was opened.
Donde Dios tuvo tratos.
Where God has had different treaties.
Por ejemplo, vemos que estaba Adán.
We see that there was Adam. Mm-hmm.
En el huerto.
Adam in the garden.
Y afuera del huerto había otra humanidad.
And outside the garden there was another humanity.
Cuando ellos fueron echados del huerto.
When they were casted out of the garden.
Caín fue a tomar a una de las hijas de esa humanidad que había para esposa.
Cain went and took one of those women from those humanities, and she became his wife.
Entonces, más adelante vemos en Génesis 6 que habían diferentes tipos o clases de humanos, o de habitantes en la tierra, más bien dicho.
Todavía no está ahí, ¿verdad? So in Genesis 6, further down, we see that there were different types of inhabitants as giants on earth.
Y entonces podemos ver que habían gigantes, habían hijos de Dios caídos, habían hombres.
We see that there were giants, we see fallen children of God, we see different types of men.
Si quieres, lees Génesis 6:1.
Se fue en... ¿Qué diapositiva está?
No, eso buscaba en la Biblia.
Okay. So we're going to read Genesis 6:1. Give me one second. Let me just go there. And it reads... ¿Solo el 6:1?
No, en adelante. Hasta hasta el 6:6.
Okay. So Genesis 6:1-6. It says, when men began to multiply on the face of the land and daughters were born to them, the sons of God saw that the daughters of men were attractive, and they took as their wives and they chose. Then the Lord said, my spirit shall not abide in men forever, for he is flesh, and his days shall be 120 days. The Nephilim were on the earth in those days, and also afterward, when the sons of God came into the daughters of men, and they bore children to them. These were the mighty men of who were of old, the men of renown. The Lord saw that the wickedness of men was great in the earth, and that every intention of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. And the Lord regretted that he had made men on the earth, and he grieved him to his heart.
Okay. Si nosotros consideramos aquí, hay diferentes creaciones. Hay hombres.
If we consider this scripture, there is men.
Hay hijos de Dios.
There is sons of God.
Hay gigantes.
There is giants.
Hay gibores o héroes de la antigüedad.
There is also gibors or heroes of old.
Hay hijas de hombres.
There is daughters of men.
Entonces aquí vemos hay cinco tipos de creaciones.
So in just alone in this passage is five different creations.
Y entonces de esas creaciones nace la idea de que cuando los hijos de Dios vieron que las hijas de los hombres eran hermosas, bajaron.
And from this is more the idea that when the sons of God saw that the daughters of men were attractive, they came down.
Eso lo podemos concatenar con el libro de Job, que es el libro más antiguo de la Biblia.
We can join this with the book of Job, which is the oldest book in the Bible.
Porque la palabra ahí que se refiere a hijos de Dios es los Ben Elohim.
Because the word there that reads the sons of God is the word Ben Elohim.
Y esta palabra es aplicada a personas, a seres que no son como nosotros.
And this word is applied to beings that are not like us.
Y entonces podemos considerar que dentro de los hijos de Dios sube Satanás.
So we can consider that amongst the children of God, Satan rises up.
Y entonces aquí lo podemos ver en Job 2:1.
If we read the book of Job, chapter 2, verse 1.
Y ahí vemos que los hijos de Dios se presentaron delante de Dios, delante del Señor. Y ahí con ellos estaba también Satanás.
We see, give me one second, let me just come to the scripture. So it says, again, there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord. And Satan came also among them to present himself before the Lord.
Entonces, existe una situación. Está la historia contada por el Señor. So y está la historia que cuentan las culturas antiguas.
So there is two things. The history or the story told by the Lord and the story told by the different cultures, the ancient cultures.
Y aquí podemos ver en la diapositiva número 4, ahí habla de la mitología.
If we go to the slide number 4 in your presentation that I sent you, in here it speaks about mythology.
Observemos, sí, quiero que se los leas. Observemos que ninguna mitología de ninguna cultura del mundo va a decir que todo se creó aquí en la tierra. Todas las mitologías hablan de seres que vinieron.
Let's observe that no mythology will speak about everything being created here on earth. Every mythology teaching will speak of things that happened outside of the earth and came to earth.
Entonces, ahora sí leamos esa, lo que habla de la mitología ahí, de los
años. I'm going to read this to you. According to the Mesopotamian mythology, the Anunna were initially the most powerful gods and lived with Anu in heaven. Subsequently, without a clear reason for this change having been established, it was the Ijigi, considered as a celestial gods, while the term Anunna was used to designate the gods of the underworld, especially seven gods who served as judges in the underworld. Atrahasis claims that before the creation of men, the gods had to work to live. Then the Anunna managed to get a lower category of gods, the Ijigi, to work for them until they rebelled and refused to continue working. Enki then created humanity so that it would take responsibility for performing the tasks that the lesser gods had abandoned and through the cult will supply foods to the gods or through the worship. In the Enuma Elish poem, it was Marduk who created humanity and then divided the Anuna between heaven and earth and assigned them tasks. Next, the Anuna, grateful to Marduk, founded Babylon and built a temple in his honor called Esagila.
Okay, si nosotros vemos acá, algo bien tremendo es que habla de la mitología mesopotámica.
If we pay attention first, it speaks of the Mesopotamian mythology.
Podríamos hablar de la mitología egipcia, de la griega, de
we
la maya.
Speak of the Greek or Egyptian or Mayan mythology.
Pero me interesa la mitología mesopotámica porque ahí es donde se cree que empezó la humanidad.
But I am interested in this mythology because it speaks of the beginning of humanity.
Según lo que dicen los científicos, la humanidad empezó en África.
According to what scientists say, humanity began in Africa.
Lo que ha habido, lo que ha, lo que se ha dicho acerca de eso es que los prototipos de hombres que aparecieron como el Pithecanthropus erectus, fueron primeramente africanos.
So what it says there is that the first types of men that appeared, that showed up, appeared first in Africa.
Ahora, cuando vemos el caso de Mesopotamia es diferente.
Now when we read in this Mesopotamian information is different.
Porque la humanidad que se crea ahí es una humanidad perfecta.
Because what it's referring here to is a perfect humanity.
A diferencia de la otra que es una humanidad evolucionada.
Different from the other humanity that scientists speak about, which is a humanity that went through an evolution.
Cuando ustedes van a Génesis van a encontrar un río muy famoso que es el Tigris.
When we read in Genesis, we're going to find a very famous river, which is the Tigris River.
La palabra Mesopotamia significa tierra entre dos ríos.
The word Mesopotamia means land between two rivers.
Y esos ríos son precisamente el Tigris y el Éufrates.
And those two rivers are precisely the Tigris River and the Euphrates River.
Toda la palabra de Dios, la Biblia, como nosotros la conocemos, empieza con el río Tigris en Génesis y termina con el río Éufrates en Apocalipsis.
The word of God begins with the Tigris River in Genesis and ends in the Euphrates River in Revelations.
Entonces, nos debe de interesar poderosamente qué fue lo que pasó ahí.
So we should be interested, very interested in what happened there.
Veamos lo que dice Efesios 1:10.
Let's read at what Ephesians 1:10 says. It says to be put into effect when the times reach their fulfillment to bring unity to all things in heaven and on earth under Christ. In him, solo el 10? O el 11 también.
10 y 11. 1:10 y 1:11 está okay. En la quinta diapositiva.
Sí, ahí estoy. In him we were also chosen, having been predestined according to the plan of him who works out everything in conformity with the purpose of will. And just as a clarification on the Spanish version and where the word fulfillment is, we have in the Spanish version the word dispensation.
Esta palabra dispensación viene de oikonomía.
The word dispensation comes from the word oikonomía.
Y esta palabra de ahí viene la economía, donde podemos decir que hay una economía antiguo testamentaria y una economía nuevo testamentaria.
So if you pay attention to the meanings which you have in your slide on top, one of the meanings, it's administration, dispensation, stewardship, but one of the meanings is economy. And this is why we use the term sometimes Old Testament economy and New Testament economy.
Pero también aquí podemos ver que esto se entiende como dispensación, que es una pequeña administración o pequeñas administraciones de todos esos tiempos de Dios.
So we also see here that it means the word dispensation. So we understand that these are small administrations applied by God for different periods of time.
Leamos la número 6.
Let's read dispensation. In the theological sense, it corresponds to a period during which man is put to the test with reference to a certain specific revelation of the will of God. Dispensationalism is a method of interpreting history which divides the work and purposes of God towards humanity into different periods of time.
Por muchos años hemos estudiado las dispensaciones.
For many years, we have studied the different dispensations.
Para poderlas entender, tenemos que tener algunas reglas.
For us to be able to understand it, we must have some rules.
Leamos la diapositiva 7.
So it says first, it is impossible to interpret the Bible in its normal and literal sense without realizing that there are different ages and different dispensations. Second, a second principle is that of progressive revelation. That is, the fact recognized by virtually all students of Scripture that revelation is given in stages. And third, all expositors of the Bible will need to recognize that a later revelation to some degree augments a primary revelation with a resulting change in life rules in which new requirements can be changed, modified, and added.
¿Sigamos leyendo?
En la primera creación?
Sí.
Okay, the first creation then in Genesis 1:11, it says, in the beginning, God created the heaven, 1:1. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. It is also known as Genesis 0. Here, God already allows us to see that there was already creation. In Isaiah 45:18, it says, for that said Jehovah who created the heavens, he is God, the one who formed the earth, the one who made it and composed it. He did not create it in vain, so that it might be inhabited. He created it. I am Jehovah, and there is no other. From Genesis 1:1 to Genesis 1:2, we can see that there was already some kind of judgment because in verse 1, there was already creation, and verse 2, the creation that had already been created is non-existent. The judgment that we see here is a flood, since in verse 2, it says that the Spirit of God moves on the waters, and the waters equals a flood. And 2, and the earth was without form and void, and the darkness was, in Genesis 1:2, on the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God moved on the face of the waters. In Jeremiah 4:23, we see, I looked up on the earth, and behold, it was desolate and empty, and to the heavens, and there was no light in them.
Para poder hacer un mejor análisis, no podemos obviar las primeras tres reglas.
For us to be able to make a good analysis, we cannot avoid or not utilize the first three rules.
La primera regla se resume en que Dios tiene diferentes tiempos.
The first rule summarizes itself in understanding that God has different ages.
Y la segunda es que Dios se revela progresivamente.
The second rule is that God reveals himself progressively.
Tercero,
vamos a necesitar
saber que en algún momento una revelación anterior puede ser aumentada o puede en algún momento no haber sido válida porque lo interpretamos mal. Y la otra, porque Dios puede mostrarnos aún cosas más profundas.
And the third, we will need to understand that a prior revelation could be augmented. It could be changed because it was rendered invalid, whether it's because of a bad interpretation or because more revelation was brought forth.
Ahora, veamos Génesis 1:1.
Let's look at Genesis 1:1.
Dios creó los cielos y la tierra.
And it says that in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth.
Les había hablado la semana, creo que pasada, de que el Señor había creado por lo menos 10 cielos.
I spoke to you, I believe, last week about God and how he created at least 10 different heavens.
Y en esa creación de lo que se conoce como los Shamayim.
And in that creation that is known as the Shamayims,
tuvo creaciones cósmicas.
In there, he had cosmic creations.
De seres que están en el cosmos.
Of beings that are in the cosmos.
Y de ahí partimos de que después crea la tierra.
And then we come and understand that he created earth.
Dentro de la creación de los cielos, ahí abarca soles, estrellas, nuestro sistema planetario, y después un énfasis en nuestro planeta.
In the creation of the heavens, within that, we see the creation of the planets, of the universe, of the different systems, and then we focus in on the creation of Earth.
En esta creación, la Edad Media no podía entender Génesis 1.
In this revelation, in this creation,
Edad Media, o sea,
the Middle Ages. No me recordaba. The Middle Ages could not understand this verse.
Entonces, en la Edad Media, pensaban que la Tierra era plana.
In that time, they thought that Earth was flat.
Pensaban que la Tierra era el centro del universo.
And they thought that Earth was the center of the universe.
Pero aquí lo que dice es que hubo una creación de cielos y tierra.
But what it says here is that there was a creation of heavens and earth.
Y cuando me digo tierra, ¿será que se refiere a este planeta o a toda la tierra cósmica? Porque en todos los soles hay sistemas planetarios como nosotros y hay tierra. Por ejemplo, en Marte hay tierra.
Mm-hmm.
Pues cuando dice Dios creó los cielos y la tierra, ¿no será algo más general?
Ok, en inglés no se dice tierra, se dice earth. Y como tierra, tiene otra palabra que se usa. Entonces, cuando yo digo earth, es una cosa, y cuando yo digo tierra, es otra cosa.
Ok.
Por ejemplo, soil. Entonces, ahí me cuesta el explicarles esta traducción porque aplica en el español solamente.
Ok, y cuando dice en inglés, creo los cielos y la tierra, es earth, lo que...
Dice earth, yes.
Ok, perfecto. Mm-hmm. De ahí tenemos que en Isaías 45:18,
okay.
Ya muestra que Dios cuando hizo la tierra, no la hizo vacía.
Mm-hmm. Ok, ¿verdad? So in Isaiah 45:18, we already see that when God created earth, he did not create it to be empty or void.
Por lo tanto, entre el verso 1:1 y el verso 1:2 tuvo que haber algo.
So in between verse 1:1 and verse 1:2, there had to be something in there.
Porque vemos acá de que la tierra después estaba desordenada y vacía.
Because then we see that earth then was void and empty. Sí.
Y que las aguas cubrían toda la faz de la tierra.
And that the waters were covering the face of the earth.
Entonces, de alguna forma, tuvo que haber habido algún tipo de diluvio.
So there had to be some kind of flooding.
Entonces, después dice que el Espíritu de Dios se movía en la faz de las aguas y se concatena con Jeremías 4:23.
Then we see that the Spirit of God moved on the face of the waters, and this is related to Jeremiah 4:23.
Okay. Y Jeremías está teniendo una visión de la tierra que estaba asolada.
Yeah. And Jeremiah is having a vision of earth that was desolate.
Eso nos dice que hubo una destrucción, una primera destrucción.
This tells us that there was a first destruction.
Aquí tenemos una lista de los cuatro prototipos de hombre que hubo antes de que apareciera Adán en el huerto.
We have here a list of the first four types of men that existed before Adam showed up in earth. Los leo.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to have to forgive my pronunciation because I don't know them. So the Australopithecus, that lived 2 or 3 million years ago and measured 1.30 meters of height. The fossil remains of this reveal that it had a highly developed skull and an ape-like jaw. It was probably carnivorous. The Homo habilis, the first remains of the Homo habilis and Homo erectus were found together. They are believed to have lived 1.6 million years ago, respectively, meaning that it is highly likely that both species existed at almost the same time and in the same place. The Homo erectus, he had enormous cranial capacity. In 1891, the first fossil remains were discovered on the island of Java. The Neanderthal, the fossil remains have revealed that they constituted a very complex human group, at the same time close to and different from us, even being able to mix with the first modern men. And the Cro-Magnon, his remains were discovered in France in the last century. He lived 40,000 years ago.
Esto fue la conclusión a la que llegó Charles Darwin con su libro El origen de las especies.
This is where Charles Darwin arrived in his conclusion in the book The Origin of the Species.
Y esto ha sido motivo para que muchas personas empiecen a creer en la teoría evolucionista y no en la teoría creacionista.
And this is the base of where some people have begun to believe in the evolution theory rather than in the existential theory.
El problema es que todas las culturas antiguas dicen lo contrario. Dice que hubo creación, incluso las culturas que no son cristianas.
The problem is that all of the ancient cultures, even those cultures that are not Christian based, those cultures specify that there was a beginning that was not here on earth.
Entonces, ¿de dónde aparecieron todos estos restos?
Where did all of these fossils and remains have come from?
Es tan sencillo como decir Dios los creó.
It is as simple as saying God created them.
Pero no eran llamados hombres.
But they were not called men.
En hebreo se diría ish.
In Hebrews it would be said ish.
De donde viene la palabra Eva, que es Isha.
Where the word...
Perdón. De donde viene la palabra varona, que es Isha.
Where the word woman comes from, which is the word Isha.
Entonces, Ish e Isha es Adán y Eva.
So, Ish and Isha is Adam and Eve.
Son dos almas totalmente perfectas.
It is two perfect souls.
Y que definitivamente tienen, por lo que se puede ver, una relación con Satanás.
Esas dos almas.
Si esas dos almas tuvieron, porque Satanás dice que se paseaba en el Edén, o sea que Satanás estaba en el Edén.
And if we read, it says that Satan had a connection with them because he was in the garden. So he also was seen or is found in the garden.
Luego vemos la segunda creación, que sería la primera raza.
We see the second creation. Oh my goodness, I have it in Spanish. Give me 1 second, okay? I'm just going to change this to the English, and I'm going to go and copy the translation that I had. Voy a salir y voy a traer la traducción.
¿De cuál? ¿De raza?
De la raza.
Okay.
Give me 1 second. Take this as a break. second, please. And I'm going to send you the updated presentation where you can have it in English. Since you know, good to have it in Spanish. One second, please. Okay. So the first creation or the first read in Genesis 1:26 and Genesis 1:3, and God said, let there be light, and there was light. On verse 3, which says God begins to create again. And on verse 24 and 27, he begins to order what, one second. He begins to put, he begins to put in order what he created. In Genesis 1:24, it says, then God said, let the earth produce living beings according to their kind, beasts and serpents and animals of the earth according to their species. And it was so. And God made animals of the earth according to their kind, and livestock according to their kind, and every animal that crawls on the ground according to its species. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, let us make men in our image, after our likeness, and rule over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the heavens, over the beasts, over all the earth, and over every animal that crawls on the earth. And God created man in his own image, in the image of God created he him, male and female he created them. The first Adam in Genesis 1:26, 27, here Adam means men or creation. Already on verse 27, created male and female. This creation was to inhabit the earth. In Genesis 1:27, it says that he created men in his image. But after, one second. But after this, there has to be another judgment, the flood, since in Genesis 2:5, it says that there was no man to till the earth because of the flood. In Genesis 2:6, that says that steam was rising, and steam rises from the earth after it rained. Okay.
Okay. Entonces aquí podemos ver tres creaciones rápidamente.
So we see three creations here very quickly.
La creación que hubo entre Génesis 1 y Génesis 2.
The creation that
Génesis 1:1, Génesis 1:2.
The creation that existed between Genesis 1:1 and Genesis 1:2.
Esa es la primera creación. La segunda creación, que es la que nosotros conocemos, que es la que nos fue revelada a nosotros.
The second creation, which is the one that we know and the one that was revealed to us.
Entre esa creación y esa otra, hubo un diluvio o algo similar.
In between the first creation and the second one, there was a flooding.
Luego, ahí en esa segunda creación, crea hombre y mujer.
And then in that second creation, he creates men and women.
Pero después aparece como que hubo otra destrucción.
Then it appears as if there was another destruction.
Y dice que no había hombre para que labrase la tierra.
And it says that there was no man to till the earth.
Aparece la creación adánica.
And then we see the Adamic creation.
Y después aparece ya una creación mezclada entre los que cayeron en pecado y la creación que estaba paralela.
And then we see a mix between those who were created and the ones that fell into sin and mixed themselves with the parallel creation that was outside of the garden.
A todo esto se le llama la primera dispensación.
All of this is called the first dispensation.
Leamos el número 12, la diapositiva yeah. número 12.
Okay, it says the first dispensation is called the innocence dispensation in Genesis 1:28 to the 30th and then 2:15 to the 17th. This dispensation covers the period of Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. In this dispensation, God's commands were populate the earth with children, subdue the land, have dominion over animals, take care of the garden, and refrain from eating the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. This came to an end by the disobedience of Adam and Eve.
Esto terminó por desobediencia.
So it came to an end because of disobedience.
O sea, que si nosotros analizamos muy bien esto, nos damos cuenta de que lo que Dios quería siempre era eliminar la desobediencia.
If we pay attention to this, we will realize that what God wanted from the beginning is to get rid of disobedience.
Observemos que ya la rebelión diabólica ya se había dado.
Let's understand that the rebellion of the devil had already taken place.
Y la primera gran rebelión ya se había dado también.
And the first great rebellion had already taken place also.
O sea, ya había habido la primera rebelión que era la de la maldad, la iniquidad y la muerte.
The first rebellion which involved evil, iniquity and death had already taken place.
Ya había habido la segunda rebelión que era la de Satanás.
And then there was the second rebellion which was the rebellion of Satan.
Ya Satanás tenía sojuzgada a la creación fuera del huerto.
Satan had already subdued the creation that was outside of the garden.
Y ahora quería sojuzgar a la creación dentro del huerto.
And now he wanted to subdue the creation inside of the garden.
O sea que ya llevaba básicamente una gran cantidad de contaminados.
So he had added on to those who he had contaminated.
Lo podemos ver más claro en la diapositiva número 13.
We can see this more clearly on the third creation, which reads in Genesis 2:7, Genesis 2:47, 2:47 or 2:4 to the 7, right? Del 4 al 7, es verdad? Genesis 2, sí. Del 4 al 7.
Sí. Sí.
That's Genesis 2, verse 4 to verse 7. And it says in verse 4, these are the origins of heaven and earth when they were created in the day that Jehovah God made the earth and the heavens, and every plant in the field before it was in the earth, and every herb in the field before it was born. For Jehovah God had not yet made it rain on the earth, nor was there a man to till the earth, but a steam came up out of the earth, which watered the entire face of the earth. Then Jehovah God formed men from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nose the breath of life, and man was a living being. From here for our days, it is believed that there are 6,000 years. From behind, this is where the dinosaurs likely lived. Here starts the creation of Adam, which is his own name, who was not going to live on earth, but was going to live in the garden. This creation is where we come from. In Genesis 2:19, it says, Yehovah therefore formed from the earth every beast of the field and every bird of the from heaven, and brought them to Adam to see what he was to call them, and all that Adam called the living beings, that is their name.
Entonces aquí en esta tercera creación es donde se levanta la segunda raza.
So in this third creation is where we get the second race.
Pero observemos aquí que es la segunda raza a la que le llaman hombre.
But let's observe that it is the second race that is called men.
O sea que el hombre tal y como lo conocemos es un ser que tiene 6,000 años sobre la tierra.
So men, as we know him, it is a creation that has existed for about 6,000 years here on earth.
Desde que el hombre cayó.
From the fall of men.
Porque antes en el huerto no se sabe cuántos años vivieron.
Because we don't know how many years they lived in the garden.
Y definitivamente para que Eva llegara a ser madre de los vivientes es porque definitivamente tuvieron que pasar mucho tiempo dentro del huerto sin pecar.
And for Eve to be called mother of the living, which is a creation or which is a separate type of men in themselves. So when we say mother of the living, this is different from the children that were born to her after she was casted from the garden.
This Hay otra razón. Sí, perdón.
Solo le estoy explicando, papá, porque cuando la palabra vivientes se dice living en inglés y la palabra living es como vivir. Entonces,
se tiene que vivos.
Hacer una aclaración. Ajá. Se tiene que hacer la aclaración de que son diferentes a los hijos nacidos fuera del
biológicamente.
So there was a different type of creation, not creation, but a different type of birth. Those who were born outside of the garden by a biological way, which is through them being together. And there were the living, which are mentioned also in the Bible. And Eve is called the mother of the living, which they are those who were born in the garden. So many years had to go by for her to be a mother in the garden. Okay.
Ahora, cuando nosotros vemos todo esto, entendemos que en esta dispensación van a empezar a surgir culturas.
Okay. So when we look at this dispensation, we will see that cultures will begin to appear.
Y definitivamente en la dispensación adánica fue donde se empezaron a manifestar las primeras visitaciones de seres de otros mundos registradas, porque han de haber habido antes de otra forma, pero ya ahí quedaron registradas. Cuando en Génesis 6:11 se determina que sí hubo ese tipo de visitaciones.
Okay. So in this dispensation of Adam, we see how visitations from other places outside of the earth begin to take place. And we see those that are registered in the Bible, we see them registered in Genesis 6. But definitely there were others, and we must think of others that happened or took place before that.
Analicemos la segunda dispensación en la diapositiva 14.
Let's analyze the second dispensation. The second dispensation is called the consciousness dispensation, and it lasted about 1,656 years from the time of the expulsion of Adam and Eve from the Garden of Eden until the flood in Genesis 3:8 and 8:22. This dispensation demonstrates what humanity will do if it is left to its will and conscience, which has been tainted by its inherited sinful nature. The five most important aspects of this dispensation are a curse on the snake, a change in femininity and motherhood, a curse on nature, an imposition of labor on humanity to produce food, and the promise of Christ as the seed that would strike the serpent on the head, which is Satan.
Ahí vemos las dos cosas bien distintas. Ahora analicemos la 15 y la 16 de una vez. Veámoslas de una vez.
Reading on third creation, third race, Genesis 6:14. It happened that when men, Adam, began to multiply on the face of the earth and daughters were born to them, then seeing the sons of God, heavenly son, that the daughters of men were beautiful, they took wives for themselves, choosing between all. And Jehovah said, my spirit will not contend with men forever, for he is certainly flesh, but its days will be 120 years. There were giants, Nephilims, on the earth in those days, and also after the sons of God, which has fallen angels, came to the daughters of men and begot sons for them. These were the brave, the Gibarim, who since ancient times were renowned men. And in Genesis 4:16-17, it says, and Cain went out from the presence of Jehovah and dwelt in the land of Nod, east of Eden. And Cain met his wife, who conceived and gave birth to Enoch. And he built a city and called the name of the city after his son Enoch. The Bible says that Cain knew his woman, but here we can ask the question where that woman came from. If up to this part of the Bible, we only found Adam and Eve, Cain and Abel, as God always leaves a remnant. The woman of Cain may be a remnant of the second creation.
Bueno, entonces ahora podemos ver claramente la segunda dispensación.
So we see clearly the second dispensation.
En esta dispensación las cosas cambian totalmente.
In this dispensation, things change completely.
Es una dispensación donde ya es una humanidad caída.
It is a dispensation for a fallen humanity.
Y entonces podemos ver acá una relación de la humanidad caída con la humanidad paralela.
So we see here already a relationship taking place between the fallen humanity with the parallel humanity.
Entonces ahora aquí hay una civilización que es básicamente la que dicen que fue la que principió la tierra.
Okay,
se supone que Nod ha de haber sido algún sumerio.
Ok, esta diapositiva no la leí.
La 17.
La 17 que es la 18 para mí. Sumerians. No. Mm-hmm. So the Sumerians were the first settlers of what would be the first civilization. Mesopotamia, that piece of land between the Tigris and the Euphrates rivers, also known as the Fertile Crescent. Although the origin of the Sumerians is not known for sure, there are records of their existence from 3500 BC. It was there that the first permanent human settlements developed and where the invention of agriculture would take place thanks to the fertility of the land. It was they who created the first city-states controlled by monarchs. The Sumerian people were the first to use writing with cuneiform writing. They created the first written system of laws and were the forerunners of scientific and medical studies along with the Egyptian ones. The Sumerian architectural constructions are the oldest in the world. What happened to them? And did the flood cause any strain? Did they disappear? Okay. So ya está.
Pusiste las fotografías, ¿no?
Yes, the pictures are here.
Va, pone las fotografías ahí. Okay. Aquí podemos ver algunas manifestaciones de personajes que aparecen en las ruinas que no precisamente son humanos.
In here we see representations of beings in the ruins that are not necessarily human.
¿Qué era lo que ellos estaban fotografiando con esto? O sea, ¿qué era lo que estaban esculpiendo?
What were they sculpting? What represented what they were looking at? What representations are these?
Todos los arqueólogos actuales coinciden en que estos seres no eran de la tierra.
All of the current archaeologists coincide in saying that these beings were not from Earth.
Y que definitivamente no los pudieron crear en sus mentes, sino que tuvieron que verlos.
And they definitely say that these were not beings created in their minds, but that definitely they had to have seen them or look at them in order to sculpt them.
En la diapositiva número 20 podemos ver claramente a los hijos de Dios caídos, deformados.
Okay.
Que se acercan a las hijas de los hombres.
In the third creation, we see the children of God, or the sons of God, already deformed, the fallen sons of God, deform and mixing with women. And it says in Genesis 6:14, it happened that when men, Adam, began to multiply on the face of the earth, and daughters were born to them, then seeing the sons of God, the heavenly sons, that the daughters of men were beautiful, they took wives for themselves, choosing between all. And Jehovah said, my spirit will not contend with men forever, for he is certainly flesh, but its days will be 120 years. There were giants, Nephilims, on the earth in those days, and also after the sons of God, the fallen angels came to the daughters of men and begot sons for them. These were the brave Giverim, who since ancient times were renowned men.
Okay, pero ahora tenemos que considerar algo. Mm-hmm. La palabra de Dios dice que a ningún ángel Dios le ha llamado hijo.
Okay, we need to consider this. The word of God says that God has not called any angel his son.
Entonces, los que cayeron fueron hijos celestiales y también cayeron ángeles.
So those who fell were heavenly sons and also angels fell.
Entonces, estos ángeles y estos hijos tenían la capacidad de poder engendrar humanas.
So this ángeles e hijos, ¿verdad?
Sí.
So
this, dos cosas aparte.
So these fallen angels, which is one type of fallen creation, and also the fallen children of God, had the capacity to engender daughters of men in order for them to bear children.
Y entonces aquí podemos considerar de que estos seres que están copiados en algunas de las culturas, pues definitivamente tuvieron que ver con esos que cayeron.
Okay, so we can understand then that what we see sculpted in the ancient cultures have definitely something to do with these fallen creations, fallen angels and fallen sons of God.
Como son siete dispensaciones y vamos por la terminando la segunda, entonces vamos a dejar las demás para el próximo domingo. Pero no sé si hay alguna pregunta o alguna duda.
Ok. Ya no leo entonces la diapositiva de la tercera dispensación, ¿verdad?
No, porque llegaste hasta la 21, ¿no?
Llegué hasta la... Sí, hasta la 21. Pues la 21 es la que lees o la tercera dispensación.
Léela entonces, sí.
So the third dispensation is the human government dispensation, which started in Genesis 8. God had destroyed life on earth with the universal flood, saving only one family to restart the human race. God gave the following promises and commands to Noah and his family. God would no longer curse the earth again. Noah and his family should repopulate the earth with people. They would have dominion over the animal kingdom. They were allowed to eat meat. The capital punishment law is established. There would never be another universal flood. And the sign of God's promise would be the rainbow. Noah's descendants did not scatter and repopulate the earth as God commanded them. Therefore, they fail in their responsibility in this dispensation. About 325 years after the flood, the inhabitants of the earth began to build a tower, a great monument to their solidarity and pride. This is in Genesis 11:7-9. And God ended construction, creating different languages and forcing his mandate to repopulate the earth. The result was the birth of different natures and cultures. Since then, human governments have been a reality. Okay.
Aquí termina la tercera dispensación, entonces empieza la segunda dispensación y empieza ya la dispensación del gobierno humano.
So we saw the first and second dispensations, and this would be the third dispensation where human or government begins.
O sea que el diluvio rompió con los gobiernos que habían anteriormente, que en algunos casos no eran humanos.
So the flood, the great flood, broke with the different governments that were taking place before, which were not entirely human. But this dispensation begins with human governments. Okay.
Okay. ¿Alguien quiere hacer alguna pregunta?
So we're going to continue during the week with the remaining four dispensations. But Apostle Fernando wants to know if any one of you has any questions. How many years did Adam and Eve live outside Eden Garden after they were expelled? Okay. ¿Cuántos años vivieron Adam y Eva fuera del jardín después de que fueron expulsados del jardín? ¿Cuál fue? ¿Cuántos años fueron?
En 935 creo que fue que vivió Adán, supongo yo.
I believe that Adam lived 935 years, but let me...
Aquí se los voy a leer.
I'm going to read this to you.
Fueron 930 años.
It was 930 years that they lived. Adam lived after they were expelled from the garden. Esto fue después de que fue expulsado del jardín. Yes.
Sí.
Yes. Anyone else? Silence.
Vivieron tantos años porque el sistema no era, el sistema climático no era como el de nosotros.
They lived for such a long amount of time or amount of years because their climate was not like the climate that we have.
Y digamos que en Ezequiel 28:13.
In Ezekiel 28:13.
Habla del gobierno de Satanás en el Edén.
It speaks of the government of Satan in the garden. Ezekiel 28:13.
Mm-hmm.
Ezekiel 28:13, it says, "Thou wast in Eden, the garden of God. Every precious stone was thy covering, the sardis, the topaz, and the diamond, the beryl, the onyx, and the jasper, the sapphire, the emerald, and the cavern coal, and the gold, the workmanship of thy tabrets, and of thy pipes, and was in thee. In the day that was that thou was created, they were prepared." Mm-hmm. Baba?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Natalie.
Okay. Perfect. Ahí estamos.
So he was there. He was in the garden. Mommy, I was not clear at the area. Okay. Something born outside of the garden. Yes. Hay una pregunta con respecto a los vivientes. No están claros entre los vivientes que nacieron dentro del jardín y los que nacieron afuera del jardín. So there is a need of clarification between Eve being called the mother of the living, and then those who were born inside of the garden and outside of the garden. Vemos, ¿verdad? Donde ella fue llamada madre de los vivientes, ¿verdad?
Sí. Okay, en Génesis 5:2.
Okay, in Genesis 5:2, one second.
Dice, varón y hembra los crió, los bendijo y los llamó Adán, el día en que fueron creados.
Man, male and female created he them and blessed them and called their name Adam in the day they were created.
O sea que el primer nombre de Eva fue Adán.
So the first name of Eve was Adam.
¿Verdad?
Mm-hmm.
De ahí podemos ver que después le llamó le llamó Adán a Eva Isha.
And then we see
le llamó varona.
That Adam called Eve Isha. Eso está en donde, papá.
Génesis 2:23.
And Genesis 2:23, he called her Isha. Hold on, 2:23. It says, and the man said, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh, and she shall be called woman, because she is taken out of men. So she shall be called Isha, because she was taken out of Ish.
Entonces, ese es el segundo nombre de Eva.
That's Eve's second name.
O sea, primero se llamaba Adán.
Mm-hmm. Her first name was Adam.
Después se llamaba Isha.
Then her second name was Isha or Eve.
Y de ahí se llamaba Eva, Génesis 3:20.
Okay, so first woman and then in Genesis 3:20, ¿verdad? And then in Genesis 3:20, we read, the man called his wife's name Eve, because she was the mother of all living.
Ahora, ¿cómo madre de los vivientes si no habían nacido Caín y Abel?
How was she mother of all living if Abel and Cain had not been born yet?
Caín y Abel nacieron después de que ellos pecaron y fueron sacados del huerto.
Cain and Abel were born after they were casted out from the garden.
Pero ya cuando salió del huerto, ya Eva era madre.
But when she was casted out of the garden, she was already a mother.
O sea que definitivamente Eva tuvo que tener hijos en el huerto.
So Eve had children in the garden.
Y definitivamente esos hijos estaban sin pecado.
And those children were without sin.
Esos hijos fueron llevados por el Señor a la tierra de los vivientes.
Those children were taken by God to the land of the living.
Eso es por eso, eso es acerca de la tierra de los vivientes.
And that is in reference to the land of the living, and you can find or read about that in Psalms 27:13, when it says, I remain confident of this, I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Okay.
¿Alguna otra pregunta?
I don't know if that helps to understand a little bit more. I mentioned, could you please explain details once again, six types of soil tender. Okay, Ayuna, there is a question that is not in reference to this teaching, but in reference to the leadership class, and it's in reference to the six types of soil and four different types of leader. This is limited. Okay. So, él solamente, él quisiera saber, no con respecto a esta clase, sino con respecto a la clase de liderazgo, que si se puede explicar más detalladamente los seis diferentes tipos de tierra y los cuatro diferentes tipos de liderazgo. Y déjeme buscar esas diapositivas si tienen tiempo de hacerlo.
Los seis diferentes tipos de tierra.
Ya. Yeah.
Me interesa más explicarles los tipos de tierra buena.
Ok. So, permítame un momento. Solo déjenme buscar la tierra. Let me see. Let me see if I can share this screen with you, Manny, and with everybody else, ok? So, here you see the types of leaders. And I sent this presentation, and I don't know if you were able to open it up. But you have the limited leader, the Latin leader, the leading leader, and the developed leader. Okay?
Okay.
So that's one of the answers to one of your questions. And then you were looking at the different types of soil. And let me try to see where that slide is, so that we have more of an understanding. I did not have this presentation the day of that class. It was given to me afterwards, so I had to translate it after.
No te preocupes, yo lo puedo explicar aquí.
Sí, papá, pero necesito, porque es algo que no se pudo explicar bien sin tenerlo enfrente y porque algunos de ellos tienen limitado no se acuerda, no, ¿verdad? No lo tiene ahí. Ok,
¿de so, qué? Abra, ¿de qué?
¿En
¿de
dónde
qué?
Está, ¿en dónde están los 6 diferentes tipos de tierra en la presentación de liderazgo? Pero no, no está ahí. It's okay.
Yo te lo consigo.
He's gonna translate. He's gonna explain it. I'm gonna translate.
El about tema se llama la tierra estéril.
Ah, pero no la tengo acá.
¿No?
No, porque lo que tengo es la tierra, el tema de liderazgo.
¿Y entonces?
Entonces, ni modo. Okay. So, you saw the slide with the 4 leaderships, and now we're gonna talk about the 6 different types of soil. Expliquemos lo de los 3 diferentes, los 6 diferentes tipos de tierra.
Bueno, primero que todo, tenemos que saber que solamente son 2 tipos de tierra.
Ok. ¿Y entonces? ¿Por qué dije yo que 6?
No, espérate. Explícalo así. Son 2 tipos de tierra.
So, first of all, we need to understand that there is 2 types, 2 main types of soil.
Ok. Esos dos tipos de tierra, la tierra mala y la tierra buena.
Those 2 main types of soil, good soil and bad soil.
Tiene 6 facetas, 3 buenas y 3 malas.
Has 6 different faces, 3 good faces and 3 bad faces.
En las 6 facetas que tiene, el 6 es número de hombre.
In the 6 faces that it has, 6 is a number for men.
Y las 3 facetas del hombre estéril, mm-hmm, es la tierra mala.
Okay, so the 3 faces of men that are bad is the bad soil.
Esas 3 facetas representan cuerpo, alma y espíritu.
Those 3 faces represent body, soul, and spirit.
Y entonces tendríamos que entender que el cuerpo representa la carne.
Okay.
El alma representa los sentimientos.
Okay.
Y el espíritu representa, pues el espíritu. El espíritu representa la vida espiritual.
Okay.
Entonces, cuando la palabra dice que la tierra, la parte de la semilla cayó junto al camino, no cayó en el atrio.
Okay. So, those 3 faces represent body, soul, and spirit. Body is that out of the flesh, soul is that out of emotions, and spirit is that which is spiritual. So when in the Bible it says that the seed fell upon the side of the road, and let me go to that, those verses in the Bible, El Sembrador, ¿verdad?
Mm-hmm.
¿En qué?
¿Qué versículo?
I just want to have, yeah, it's Matthew 13, ¿verdad?
Mm-hmm.
Mateo 13. So mm-hmm. I'm just going to go to Matthew 13. So I have that open and we're able to see it better. Okay.
Estoy leyendo 13:4.
So in Matthew 13:4, and it says, and as he sowed, some seeds fell by the wayside, and the birds came and devoured them. So they did not, those seeds did not fall upon the atrium. Así es, no cayeron en el atrio, ¿verdad?
No cayeron ni siquiera en el atrio, sino que cayeron fuera. O sea, no hubo ningún buen beneficio.
There was no benefit at all in that seed, because it fell completely outside of the bounds of the soil.
Ese hombre representa al hombre carnal.
That represents a man that lives by the flesh.
De ahí tenemos los pedregales.
And then we see the rocky places.
Ese representa al hombre sentimental.
That represents the emotional man.
Vive solamente a base de emociones, pero nunca se solidifica.
He lives based out of emotions, but he is never solid.
Y de ahí está el hombre afanoso, el que vive solamente afanado.
And then is you see the man that is working, that is always at work or tired.
Ese representa a los espinos.
And that represents the thorns.
Okay, entonces aquí podemos ver un panorama.
So we see a picture here of those three types of soil.
Un panorama de esterilidad, sin fruto.
And this is a face or a picture of something that has no fruit.
Luego vemos al hombre fructífero.
And then we see the man which is fructiferous.
El que es de a 30 es el atrio.
He who is of the face of 30, production at 30, is the atrium or the entrance.
Y el que es de a 60 es del lugar santo.
And the one that is at 60, producing at 60%, he is already at the holy place.
Y el que es de a 100 ya sería el hombre espiritual.
And the one that produces at 100 is the spiritual man. Now, when we're saying atrium and holy place and holy of holies, we are referring to men, the tabernacle represented in men. So atrium would be body, holy place would be the soul, and holy of holies will be the spirit. So the good soils are those seeds that fall, that are producing at 30%, at 60%, and at 100%. At 30% is that which is producing at the flesh or the body level or the body phase. And then you have the soul phase, which is producing at 60%. And then you have the spiritual phase, which is already producing at 100%. And let me just copy paste those verses for you. Okay, they're already there. I already have them in those first, in this one. Okay?
Okay. Ahora, si analizamos esto, en el caso del hombre de a 30, tiene un 70% estéril.
Okay, so if we analyze men at 60%, a 30, ¿verdad? If es al 30%.
A 30.
If we're analyzing.
El que tiene 30 men, tiene 70 estéril.
Okay, so the one that is producing at 30, 70% is sterile. There is no fruit coming forth from the rest of the other 70%.
Entonces, yo me voy a enfocar en este.
And I'm going to focus on this one.
Analizando un poco acerca del número 70 en la Biblia.
Analyzing number 70 a little bit in the Bible.
El número 70 representa vida.
Number 70 represents life.
Representa almas.
It represents souls.
Veamos, por ejemplo, cosas que pasaron con 70 personas.
Let's see things that happened, for example, with groups of 70 people.
En Génesis 10:1, están al 32, están todos los descendientes de Sem, Cam y Jafet, que son 70 personas.
Okay, en Génesis, ¿en Génesis cuál, papá?
10, del 1 al 32.
Génesis 10, from verses 1 to 32. We have, ¿a quiénes tenemos?
Sem, Cam y Jafet. Entonces, básicamente, eso significa que 70 significa un inicio.
¿Quiénes son estos de Génesis 10, 1 al 32?
Los que poblan la tierra.
These are the ones that populate the earth.
Después del diluvio.
After the flood. Okay.
Entonces, básicamente, esos son los que inician.
So
entonces, sería que el de 30 tiene que tener un inicio.
Okay, so these are those who begin, ¿verdad?
Ajá.
Okay, so those who produce at the level of 30%, they have to begin something. This is a beginning.
Y ahí tenemos que el número 70 significa también entrenamiento.
Number 70 also means training.
Los que poblaron, los que regresaron con José a Egipto, a la tierra de José, eran 70. Éxodo 1:5.
Éxodo. Okay.
Eran 70 los que llegaron a Egipto y se volvieron 600,000 hombres de a pie, mujeres y niños cuando salieron 400 años después.
¿Eran cuántos?
70.
No, ¿cuántos salieron?
600,000 hombres, aparte de mujeres y niños. Entonces ellos fueron a ser entrenados en Egipto.
Okay. So they were trained in Egypt.
De ahí tenemos Deuteronomio 10:22.
Then we have Deuteronomy 10:22. And just on the verses before, I'm sorry, because I was typing it and I didn't tell you. So 70 were those who came to Egypt, and 400 years later, there were 600,000 men, not including women and children. And these people were trained in Egypt. So 70 equals training. And then we have Deuteronomy 10:22, and in there, y ahí encontramos.
Y entonces ahí encontramos en Deuteronomio 10:22 que se reprodujeron. Entonces el número 70 también significa reproducción.
So 70, so they reproduce. So number 70 also means reproduction.
De ahí tenemos en Éxodo 24:9.
Then we have Exodus 24:9.
Que los ancianos de Israel eran 70.
The elders of Israel were 70.
Eso se hizo con el objeto de establecer un ordenamiento.
This was with the object of establishing an ordainment.
Luego vemos en Números 11:24.
Permítame. Y vemos números, numbers.
11:24.
Numbers 11:24.
Y entonces ahí tenemos que también hay congregación.
This is also equals to congregation.
De ahí tenemos en Jeremías 29:10 que la tierra tiene que descansar 70 años.
And then we have Jeremiah 40.
70 años.
Pero,
29:10.
29:10. Jeremiah 29:10. I'm sorry. And this also says that the earth has to rest for 70 years.
Y por último, los 70 que regresaron con gozo en Lucas 10:17. Entonces aquí ya les expliqué solamente el 30, porque se nos fue el tiempo.
Esto es lo que necesitan los de 30, necesitan esto.
Sí.
So those who are producing at a level of 30% need to activate or grow into this 70 so that the rest, the 70 that they're lacking is also producing. So populate, training, they need to reproduce, they need to have an ordainment, they need to congregate. So you can study those verses that I'm pasting that for you so that you can study. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to make sure that I send you this slide again in PDF format
so that all of you have it and you can study it.
Y de ahí tenemos que la vida del hombre son 70 años.
We also see that the life of men is now 70 years.
Te voy a mandar ese tema para que se los pases ya traducido.
Okay. So, and I'm going to try to give you more information on number 70.
Se nos ha ido el tiempo, pero and las preguntas que han quedado, pues por favor me las manda.
And time has basically flown by, but if you have any other questions, please don't hesitate on letting me know and we'll continue to study it. We still have the remaining of the teaching on the 12 stones of the breastplate. And we have several other teachings that we need to conclude. And as questions arise, we touch on other subjects, but we're definitely going to get there little by little. Okay. God bless you,
God bless everybody. God bless you, Manny. God bless you, John.
God bless you, Adonis. Bye-bye.
God bless you, Benji. God bless you. Bye-bye.
Edna, bye-bye, Pastor.
Bye-bye, Edna.
Bye.
Bye. God bless you. I'll send you soon. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye, everyone.